while the dew is still on the roses, and the voice I hear falling on my ear, the Son of God discloses, and he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own, and the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known. He speaks and the sound of his voice is so sweet, the birds hush their singing, and the melody that he gave to me within my heart is ringing, and he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own, and the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known. I say in the garden with him, though the night all around me is falling, and he bids me go through the voice of woe, his voice to me is calling, and he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he says, has ever known.
All right, appreciate that this morning. Good scene, good song. Let's stand together. Shake hands, fellowship one with another. You children that are seven and under that want to go to the children's church, you can be making your way to the children's church class at this time. Thank you. right, you may be seated. Thank you so much for being with us today. Ephesians chapter 2 in your Bible, Ephesians chapter 2. Good to be saved. Good to be in the Lord's house. Good to know Jesus. Amen. Well, I'm glad I'm saved. I'm glad I'm in the Lord's house today. Amen. You can be somewhere else if you wanted to be. There's plenty of places to be. But I'm thankful that the Lord gives me a desire to fellowship with Him, worship Him, learn of Him. I'm glad the Lord gives me a desire to be together with God's people. And the Lord set this thing up so that we could fellowship together. We're not of our own. We're not individuals. We need each other. We are one body in Christ. Ephesians chapter 2. First part of Ephesians talks about our horrible condition. Before we were saved, we were in trespasses and sins. We were walking according to the prince of this world. We were following the prince and power of the air. We were children of disobedience. We were living in the lust of the flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and mind. We were by nature the children of wrath, even as others. But God, who is rich in mercy, ain't that a blessing? Sure, I'm thankful for the richness of the mercy of God, the grace of God, even when we were dead in sin. I'm glad that God made it possible for us to be saved. Like the Bible says in Romans 5:8, but God commended his love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. So we're thankful for that grace. We're thankful for his mercy. The Bible says in verse number 7 that in the ages to come he might shew the exceeding riches of his grace and his kindness toward us through Christ. And we know that we are saved by grace through faith. It's not of ourselves. It is the gift of God. And I'm thankful that it's not by works, lest any man should boast. I know if it was by works, I don't know that any of us would be able to work enough or work correctly or work faithfully enough to be saved. And if we could, the Bible said we'd boast about it. And so I'm glad salvation is by grace through faith. And because of that salvation, we are now his workmanship. We are his creation. He has created us in Christ Jesus, and he has created us unto good works. We are not saved by works, but we are saved to work. And the works is proof of our faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. The Bible said that we should walk in those good works. Now, we come to verse number 11. That's where we'll begin reading today. We read down through maybe verse number 18. We talked about verse 11 and 12 on last Sunday. We'll look at some more verses today, beginning at verse 13 primarily. But the Bible says in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 11, wherefore remember that ye being in time past Gentiles in the flesh, who are called the uncircumcision, by that which is called the circumcision in the flesh made by hands, that at that time ye were without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel, and strangers from the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. But now, in Christ Jesus, ye who sometimes were afar off are made nigh by the blood of Christ. For he is our peace, who hath made both one, and hath broken down the middle wall of partition between us, having abolished in his flesh the enemy, even the law of commandments contained in ordinances, for to make him in himself of twain one new man, so making peace, and that he might reconcile both unto God in one body by the cross, having slain the enemy thereby, and came and preached peace to you which were afar off and to them that were nigh. For through him we both have access by one Spirit unto the Father. Let's pray together. Father, thank you for the Bible. Thank you for the opportunity, Lord, to read a portion of Scripture. And are hearing today,
Thank you, Lord, for the goodness of God. Thank you for the grace of God, the mercy of God. Thankful for the free gift of salvation. I'm glad that we've been made a new creature in Christ Jesus. Lord, we begin to see in these other verses some things that God has taken two and made one. I pray, God, that you would help us to realize this unity that God expects us to have with the Father and also with each other by our new birth, our relation in Christ Jesus. Lord, would you help us today to preach? Would you give us liberty to preach? Would you remove from our hearts and our mind anything that might be a hindrance, Lord, to our preaching? Would you remove the offenses of evil, those who are contentious? Lord, would you help their hearts to be humbled? And God, would you help us to proclaim truth from your word that passes all understanding? Would you help us to say the things that are pleasing to you? Help us to refrain from saying those things that would be against your word and against your will, we ask. And Father, for all that you do, we will not fail to thank you for that. In Jesus' name, amen. On last Sunday, we talked about, from verses 11 and 12, how the despised are made welcome. We talked about, under that heading, six things. We talked about the fact that we were without circumcision. We were without Christ. We were without citizenship. We were without a covenant. We were without a Christian's hope. And we were without a creator or a God. I want to start today in verse number 13 by talking about the distant are made nigh. The Bible says in verse 13, but now in Christ Jesus, ye who sometimes were afar off are made nigh by the blood of Christ. And so the Apostle Paul, in writing here, now shows how the despised, the outcast Gentiles, are brought home. They're made nigh through the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. I want you to notice there's the same great conjunction used here in verse 13 that we see in verse number 4. I made mention just briefly a moment ago the wickedness, the depravity, the ungodliness in our lives before salvation, and we see the hopeless condition, but verse number 4 says, but God, and so there was a definite change for us, and it was God. Now that we are saved, we see again that conjunction used in verse 13, and it says, but now in Christ Jesus. And so now that we have been saved by grace through faith, verse number 8, we are now his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus, verse number 10. We are now new creatures in Christ Jesus, according to 2 Corinthians 5 and 17. We are now made nigh in Christ. And so we had a past state, the Bible says in that verse of Scripture, but now in Christ Jesus, ye who sometimes were afar off. So we were afar off. We had no hope. We had no God. We had no covenant. We had no citizenship. We had nothing as far as the Savior and salvation was concerned. But now, thank God, but now in Christ Jesus. Look, there's a great cross reference here in Acts chapter 2. I want you to come to Acts chapter 2. In Acts chapter 2, Peter is preaching. And we know that from verse number 14. And we have Peter's sermon recorded here. And he is one of the many that lifted up their voice on the day of Pentecost to preach. And he's preaching here in Acts chapter 2. And this is what he says in verse number 21. Acts chapter 2 and verse number 21. Peter said, and it shall come to pass that whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Because he didn't say whatsoever Jew shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. He didn't say whatsoever Gentile shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. He said, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. You know, the Bible says that in Romans chapter 10, verses 9 and 10 as well. The Bible says, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. What a blessing. Now let's continue. Look at verse 22. He said, ye men of Israel, hear these words. So it's very clear who he is talking to. He is talking to the men of Israel. Jesus of Nazareth, a man approved of God among you by miracles and wonders and signs, which God did by him in the midst of you, as ye yourselves also know. Verse 23. Him being delivered by the determinate counsel and foreknowledge of God, ye have taken and by wicked hands have crucified and slain. And so Peter is talking, first of all, to the children of Israel, and he is reminding them that by their wicked hands they have taken and they have slain the Lord Jesus Christ. And so Jesus Christ dies upon the cross. We see that in his sermon in verse 23. In verse number 24, I love this. I'm glad we don't serve a dead God. I'm glad we don't serve a dead Savior. I'm glad we're not serving some God with a little G. We're serving the great God, the only true and living God. We're serving the God who was able to raise Jesus Christ from the dead. Amen. Verse 24 said, whom God hath raised from the dead, has raised up, loosing the pains of death, because it was not possible that he should be holding of it. So what did Peter just proclaim in these verses of Scripture? Peter just proclaimed that Christ died, that Christ was buried, and that Christ rose again. I'm thankful for the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, the death of Christ, the burial of Christ, and the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, what did Peter tell these believers, or these people here that he's preaching to on this day? What did he tell them that they had to do? He told them that they had to believe. If they would believe, what would God do? He would save them. He said, whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Now, skip down to verse 31. He, seeing this before, spake of the resurrection of Christ. Look at verse 32. This Jesus hath God raised up, whereof we are all witnesses. Now, skip down to verse 36. Therefore, let all the house of Israel know assuredly that God hath made that same Jesus whom you have crucified, both Lord and Christ. So what is Peter preaching here in these verses of Scripture? He preaches the crucifixion of the Lord Jesus Christ. He preaches the resurrection of Jesus Christ. He is the Lord, and I'm glad that we can call him Lord. He is Lord, amen. Will you call upon his name if you will? Whosoever will can be saved. You say, well, he's preaching to Israel. That's clear in the context. Yeah, but watch what the Bible says. Look at verse 38. Then Peter said unto them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sin. Now, I want to say this just in passing so you won't think I skipped out on it. Right here, that's the third or fourth time that the word for has been used in this passage. He said, every one of you, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sin. That's the third or fourth time, I can't remember exactly, that the word has been used in this passage of Scripture. They are not being baptized to receive remission of sins. They're being baptized for the remission of sins. They're being baptized because they have received the remission of sins. Listen, have you ever talked to anyone that's in trouble or in jail? You ask them what they're in jail for, and they're in there for some crime that they have committed. It could be a number of different things, and hopefully they're not in there to continue that crime way. They're in there for the reason of that crime. I'm in here for robbery. I'm in here for assault. I'm in here for murder. I'm in here for tax evasion. Whatever the case may be, they're in there for. So you don't get baptized to receive remission of sins. You are baptized because you have received remission of your sins. Amen. Had to put that in there. It's just not part of the message, but you got to explain that when you're passing. Look at verse 38 again. Then Peter said unto them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. Now, notice verse 39. For the promise is unto you. Now, who's he talking to? He's talking to the Jews. We know that. Look what he says. And to your children. So who's he talking to? He's talking to Israel. But that ain't all. I love this next phrase. Look. And to all that are afar off. Well, who could that be? Well, according to Ephesians chapter 2, verse 13, that is you and I who are Gentiles, we're afar off. So he's preaching to Israel, he's preaching to the Jews, but he's also preaching to you and I. He's had a blessing. And so we see we got three people he names in Acts chapter 2. He talks about you, he's talking to Israel. He says, your children, he's talking to Israel. And then there's this third group, them that are afar off, he's talking about the Gentiles. And so we're talking about here in this second point of this sermon that we're preaching, that the distant are made nigh. And the first thing under that heading is the present state, you who sometime were afar off. Now here's the second thing. Come back to Ephesians chapter 2 and look at verse 13. Our past state, we were far off. The present standing, we are made nigh. Look what the Bible says, Ephesians 2, verse 13. But now in Christ Jesus, ye who sometimes. So sometimes, according to the context of the chapter, we were without Christ. We were aliens from the commonwealth of Israel. We were strangers from the covenants of promise. We had no hope. We were without God in the world. But verse 13 says, but now in Christ Jesus, ye are made nigh by the blood of Christ. And so we were once far off, now we were made nigh. We were once without circumcision, now we are under divine favor. The Bible says, if you turn backwards, just probably maybe one page in your Bible, Galatians chapter 6, maybe across the page, maybe back a page or two, Galatians 6 verse 15, the Bible says, for in Christ Jesus, neither circumcision availeth anything, nor uncircumcision, but a new creature. And so it doesn't matter if you are a Jew or if you are a Gentile. What matters is whether or not you've been made a new creature in Christ Jesus. You see, your earthly pedigree, your earthly heritage, it can only get you so far in this world. It's not going to get you anywhere in eternity. You're going to have to know Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. You're going to have to be a new creature in Christ Jesus, or you're going to spend eternity separated from God in the lake of fire and brimstone. Look what the Bible says in Acts chapter 15. Come to Acts chapter 15. Acts chapter 15. The Bible says in verse 17, we're going back to Ephesians now, if you'll hold your place there. Acts chapter 15, verse number 7. The Bible says, when there had been much disputing, Peter rose up and said unto them. Now this, Acts chapter 15, we don't have time to get hung up here, but they're having this great Jerusalem council, I like to call it, and they're having this great meeting. All these Gentiles are being saved, and the Jews are upset, the Judaizers are upset, but so they have this big meeting, and there's much disputing, there's much arguing is what that means. Peter rose up and said unto them, verse 7, men and brethren, ye know how that a good while ago God made choice among us that the Gentiles by my mouth should hear the word of the gospel and believe. Now, he's talking primarily about Cornelius and the events that took place in Acts chapter 10 and Acts chapter 11. Verse 8 said, and God, which knoweth the hearts, bear them witness, giving them the Holy Ghost, even as he did unto us, and put no difference between us and them, purifying their hearts by faith. Verse 10, now therefore, why tempt you God to put a yoke upon the neck of the disciples, which neither our fathers nor we were able to bear? But, verse 11, we believe that through the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, we, that's the Jews, shall be saved even as they, the Gentiles. And so again, we see that the Jew and the Gentile have equal opportunity to be saved. Now, come back to Ephesians chapter 2. Ephesians chapter 2. We talked about several things already. Ephesians chapter 2. We talked about the fact that we were once afar off, but now we're made nigh. We were once without circumcision, now we're under divine favor. We were once without Christ, but now we have a Savior. I won't ask you to turn there, but the Bible says in Romans 10, verse number 12, says, for there is no difference between the Jew and the Greek, for the same Lord over all is rich unto all that call upon him, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. And so there's no longer a difference as far as receiving the gospel and being saved between the Jew and the Gentile. Whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. You say, preacher, you're mentioning that over and over. I am, because the text is, and there's some other things you're going to mention over and over as well, because the text does. And if the Bible thinks it's important that things be repeated over and over and over so you can get it in your mind and so you can get it in your heart, why should we skip it or leave it out just because?
Because you don't want to hear it.
I want to hear it. I want to know what Jesus has done for me. I want to know what Jesus is continuing to do for me. And I'm thankful that he's doing this for whosoever will. Amen. Now, we were once without citizenship. Now we have a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. The Bible says, I tell you, I need to just slow down. Look at 2 Corinthians chapter 5. I tell you. We start again at 2 o'clock. I can preach till 2 o'clock. Look at 2 Corinthians chapter 5. 2 Corinthians chapter, I don't know where some of you just had a mild stroke. It's going to be okay. I'll let you go. Your mind cannot comprehend what your butt can't take. And so you won't be there long. Amen. You'll start squirming and you'll be getting up and, you know, all that kind of stuff. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, look at verse number 1. For we know that if our earthly house of this tabernacle were dissolved, we have a building of God and house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. And so, listen, we didn't have anything. I mean, we were without citizenship. Now we have a house not made with hands that's eternal in the heavens. I believe that's going to be the glorified body that you and I are going to dwell in, the body likened unto the Son of God. We're going to drop this robe of flesh. Man, are you talking about a day? Bible talks about in the book of 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, how that those that are dead in Christ are going to rise first. Then when we which are alive and remain, 1 Corinthians chapter 15 talks about we're going to drop this body of flesh. This mortal is going to become immortal. This incorruptible is going to become incorruptible. Listen, we're getting out of this thing and we're getting into something that's going to be just like the Son of God. I don't know about you, I'm still happy about it. We were once without a covenant. Now, these things I write, we had no covenant at all. Look, just one of many things that we have now. Jesus said, or the Bible says, should say, in 1 John chapter 2, verse 1, my little children, these things I write unto you that you sin not. But if any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. And so we had no covenant. We didn't have nothing. And now we have all of these wonderful things in the Lord Jesus Christ. What a blessing to be saved. Because it doesn't matter if you're a Jew. It doesn't matter if you're a Gentile. I'm glad you can put your faith and your trust in the Lord Jesus Christ. You can be made a new creature. You can be get off of the road to hell, onto the way to heaven. Your trespasses can be forgiven. You can have eternal life with the Lord Jesus Christ. Not because you're good and not because you deserve it, but because he's good, amen, and he's made the way possible for you and I to get in. I'm looking forward to going to heaven, amen. We were once without a Christian's hope, and now we rejoice in hope. Who in the Bible says in Romans chapter 5? Romans chapter 5. I'll read verse number 1. Verse number 2 is the verse I'm looking for, but why in the world would you not read verse number 1 if you're anywhere near it? Therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom also we have access by faith into this grace wherein we stand. Look, and rejoice in hope of the glory of God. Listen, are you rejoicing in hope this morning? I understand the world's full of trials, world's full of trouble, world's full of heartaches. All of us, if we could have a crying spell the rest of the afternoon, we could start here, we could go down every pew, in and out every pew. You could tell me about your trials, you could tell me about your sorrows, you could tell me about your troubles, you could tell me about the things that are bothering you. All of us could do that, and all of our hearts would be broken, and all of us would be weeping and mourning for each other. other's sorrow and each other's trials and each other's heartaches. And I'm not saying that that's not something that we ought to do. I think sometimes we ought to have more compassion one for another. But listen, I'm glad I can tell you this morning that I have been justified by faith. I have been made at peace with my God, and I can rejoice in hope. Amen.
Amen.
You got a choice. You can be discouraged. You can be down and out. You can be gloomy. I know that all of those things, all those emotions, I promise you, I have those same pity parties. I have those same troubles. I have those same days of discouragement. I have those same bouts of depression. I have all of those same things that you're going through. But friend, I'll tell you what gets my mind off of those things. I'll tell you what gets my heart off of those things. I'll tell you what gets my attention off of those things. That's the fact that I can rejoice and what he has done for me and the way that he has made for me. I'm going to glory one day. Amen. I'm going to put aside this body of flesh. This immortal is going to give way. I'll tell you, I'm going to be made just like Jesus Christ, the Bible says in 1 John chapter 3 and verse number 1. We don't understand what all those things are. I don't claim to have all the answers, but I know I'm glad I'm not going to be like me anymore. I'm going to be like him. I'm not going to have to worry about what sister so-and-so said and what brother so-and-so did. My mind is going to be focused on what he has done throughout all eternity. I say, glory to God, come and get us today, Lord. Even so, come quickly, Lord Jesus. I'm rejoicing in hope. That's where my standing is at, and that's what I'm rejoicing in. Look at Romans chapter 8. Romans chapter 8, verse 24. You don't have to turn there. I'm just going to part of the verse. We are saved by hope. Titus chapter 2. Titus chapter 2, I want you to read this one. I'll read it to you. Titus chapter 2, verse number 13. This is another one of those things that it's hard to just read one verse. Titus chapter 2, verse number 11. It says, for the grace of God that bringeth salvation hath appeared to all men, teaching us the grace of God not only save you to teach it, teaching us to deny ungodliness and worldly lust. We should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world. Here, listen. Whatever you're looking at, if you're looking around, you're comparing yourselves among others, you're discouraged. If you're looking down, you're looking back, you have no hope, you have no peace. But if you're looking to the Lord Jesus Christ, the Bible says it like this, looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Talking to this elderly man on the street yesterday, came walking by with his walker, and he was a nice elderly gentleman. He said, I don't really need this. I just push it around. And he was talking about the Lord just a minute, and he said, I sure hope he comes today. I'm looking for him. Listen, have you quit looking for Jesus? I realize that. I don't know what it was. Maybe it was just conviction when I was younger, but it seemed like when I was a young man, every sermon the preacher preached was on hell or Jesus coming. And both of them scared me to death. I certainly didn't want to go to hell. I didn't want to go to hell because I love me. And I certainly didn't want Jesus to come because I knew if Jesus come, my mom and daddy knew the Lord and they was going to be gone and I was going to be left there without them. And so, man, I want to tell you something. Hell is still real. And if you die without the Lord Jesus Christ, you're going immediately to hell. The Bible talks about that rich man in Luke 16 that died, and the Bible said that he was in torments, amen. And listen, he had his memory. He was praying. He asked Abraham to send somebody to go tell his brothers. He was thirsty. He had all these things going on in hell. Hell is real. You don't have a promise of tomorrow. You have no idea that you're going to live out the day. You have no idea that tomorrow the sun will ever rise and you'll ever see any of us again. Today may be the last day we ever meet like this again. Do you know Jesus as your Savior? You better have more than religion. You better have more than a profession. You better have more than I joined the church and I wrote my name down and I repeated this prayer. You better have a relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ that comes only by receiving Him as your Savior. Amen. And then Jesus is coming. I don't know what tomorrow holds. I don't know what's going on in Israel. I know this book has a lot to say about Israel. I mentioned a little about that this evening, like 2,500 sometimes mentioned in the Bible. God cares a lot about them. There's a lot of turmoil going on over there. There's a lot of things going on. And I'm not a prophet, and I'm not saying, I don't read into anything. I'm telling you this, Jesus is closer to coming today than he was yesterday. We are 7 days closer to the return of Jesus Christ than we were last Sunday. We are 30 days closer to the coming of Jesus Christ than we were a month ago at this time. Jesus is coming. What are you waiting on? He's going to come and you don't know him. You're going to be separated from him. You're going to be sent strong delusion. You're going to believe a lie and you're going to be damned. You'll not trust him after he comes. I don't know where all that came from. All I know is this. If you don't know Jesus, you better get saved. He's made a way for you to be saved. Amen. Our presence today, come back to Ephesians chapter 2. I got to get back to the message. Praise the Lord. I'm getting to the point where I don't care if I ever get back to the notes or not. I just want God to help me. Amen. We have a past state. We were without Christ. We have a present standing. We've been made nigh. We have a perfect sacrifice. We've been made nigh by the blood of Christ. Ephesians 1:7 says, in whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace. Redemption is a great word. I've been ransomed or delivered from the bondage of sin. I've been redeemed, amen. Listen, you know what that means? That means a sufficient price has been paid for my ransom. Now, I don't know about you, and I believe me, I have enough problems in my own mind. I don't want to know. But I know about me. And I know my past, and I know where I've been, and I know what I've done, and I know what I've thought, and I know what I've been involved in, and I know if I get too close to that, it makes a noise. I know all about that. I can't imagine what kind of price it would pay or cost to pay for all of that, but I do, because by faith I saw him one day, lifted up between heaven and earth, bearing my sins in his own body as he shed his blood across the Calvary. And whatever it is in your life, whatever, however long the list of sin is, however deep the stain goes, I'm glad that the ransom price has been paid by the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, and you can get in today, amen. Yeah, you can save today. You don't have to wait till tomorrow. You don't even have to wait for I give an invitation. You can bow your head right where you're sitting and say, Lord, I just realized that I was a sinner without God and on my way to hell. And I wish you would come into my heart and save me. You don't even have to repeat those words like that. As soon as you put your faith and your trust in the Lord Jesus Christ, he'll save you. He'll save you. I still remember several years ago, Brother Johnny Vernon got saved on a Sunday night at our church in the old building. I heard him testify over and over and over. He said, before I ever got to the altar, he said, I got up out of my pew. He said, the Lord saved me before I ever got down here. You know why? Because he was exercising faith in what the Lord Jesus Christ had done for him. The Lord saved him. Colossians 1:14 says, in whom we have redemption through his blood. Listen to this. Even forgiveness of sins. We have redemption through his blood. The Bible tells us in Ephesians 1:7, the forgiveness of sins. Colossians 1:14 repeats it somewhat, even the forgiveness of sins. There's no other acceptable payment. There's not another payment acceptable to forgive you of your sins. It takes the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. Not just any blood, his blood. Precious blood, perfect blood, innocent blood, Christ's blood. It's definitely redeemed blood. Even the forgiveness of sins. Would you forgive yourself? We have trouble. We have trouble. I'm my own worst enemy. I have trouble forgiving me. But the Lord forgave me of all my sins. Look at 1 Peter. Look at 1 Peter chapter 1. Yes, sir. It sure is. The reason we struggle with forgiving others is we struggle with forgiving ourselves. 1 Peter chapter 1. The reason we struggle with forgiving ourselves is because of pride. I said, "Preacher, you're really getting off subject now." I said, "It's okay. It's just get 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 18. For as much as you know that you were not redeemed with corruptible things of silver and gold from your vain conversation received by tradition from your fathers, but with the precious blood of Christ, as of a lamb without blemish and without spot." Romans chapter 5, verse number 9 says, "Much more than being now justified." Now justified. Not that I'm going to be justified somewhere out there in the future, but being now justified by his blood, we shall be saved from wrath through him. For if when we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his son, much more being reconciled, we shall be saved we shall be saved by his life. Now, talk about justified. There's been many different definitions used for the word justified, and I'm certainly not here to put any of them down. But justified, just as I ever sinned, just as I never sinned, or even better, made just like him. You know, I know that in this body of flesh you can't see that, but the new creature that's been created in me doesn't have a sin nature. I've been made just like him. We were condemned by our sin, but the blood of Christ has cleansed us from our sin. It's the blood of Christ that enables the sinner to have fellowship with God. And it's the blood of Christ that enables the Christian to draw near to God. His blood is powerful and effective. Now look, I have a whole nother sermon in all of this. I preach on the blood of Christ, but I just want to say that I'm just going to mention. I'm mentioning seven things about his blood, and I'll be done. The blood of Christ redeems. We just read that in 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 18 and 19. The blood of Christ cleanses. The Bible says in 1 John 1, 7, into that verse said, "The blood of Jesus Christ cleanses us from all sin." The blood of Jesus Christ brings forgiveness. We read that in Ephesians chapter 1, and we also read it in Colossians chapter 1. The blood of Jesus Christ gives peace. The Bible says in Colossians chapter 1, and verse number 20, "And having made peace through the blood of his cross, by him to reconcile all things unto himself." The only reason that I have peace with God is because of the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ that washed away my sin to make it possible for me to have fellowship with God. What a blessing. It enables us to make peace through the blood of his cross. Number five, the blood of Jesus enables us to become overcomers. I am an overcomer by the blood of the Lamb. The blood of Jesus gives us boldness before God. Number six, Romans Hebrews 10:19 says, "Having therefore, brethren, boldness to enter into the holiest by the blood of Jesus." Number seven, the blood of Jesus also gives us boldness in the day of judgment. Romans 5:9 says, "Much more being now justified by his blood, we shall be saved from wrath through him." I praise the Lord today that we're made nigh by the blood of Jesus Christ. Listen, no matter how vile, no matter how vain, no matter how vicious your life may have been, I am glad that there is sufficiency in the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ to wash away all of your sins. You may be sitting here this morning and you have the mentality that you're neutral concerning God. You don't know him as your Savior, but you're not opposed to God. Can I tell you what the Bible says about that? The Bible says you are an enemy with God. See, preacher, I don't have no animosity toward God. I don't know him as my Savior, but I am not against God. If you're not for him, you are against him. You are an enemy with God. Your sin is separated between you and your God, and you need to be reconciled. And the Lord Jesus Christ has made that possible. Listen, all sins, all failures, all corruption, and in all depravity are canceled by the precious blood of the Lord Jesus Christ that brings us nigh unto him. Here's your question today. Do you know him as your Savior? Are you born again? Have you received the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior? It's not something that you just know about or something that you read about or something that you heard about. Do you know him? I hope you do. Get Keisha to come to the piano.
if she will, play or sing. I can tell you honestly, this morning the sermon took a completely different direction than what I had planned, thought, made notes, or outlined to preach. And that's well and fine. I continually ask the Lord to do that and to preach through us and to use us. So with that being the case this morning, I don't know who you are, but I promise you there's someone here that's never been born again. You don't know Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. You're a guilty sinner. You're dead in your trespass and sin. You're fallen in the course of this world. You're of your father Satan, the Bible says. And you're separated from God. And should you die in that condition, you're going to an awful place for you. And the Bible talks about in Revelation chapter 20 how that death and hell is going to be delivered up. You're going to get out of that holding cell for a very short period of time just to stand at the great white throne of Christ, the great white throne judgment. And you're going to be bound hand and foot and cast into the outer darkness, into the lake of fire where the Bible says there's weeping and gnashing of teeth. And listen, you're not going to be there for a short period of time. You're going to be there forever and ever. Please trust Christ today. Akisha plays, Christians are praying. If the Lord has spoken to your heart today, I wish you'd come. I'd love to take a Bible and show you how you can trust Jesus to be saved.